greeting. Welcome to Mount Olive AME Church, 4630 Old State Road, broadcasting live on Sunday, February the 27th, 2002, in Holly Hill, South Carolina, where our pastor is the Reverend Malcolm O. Simpson.
Let the blessed people of God say amen. Amen. Let the blessed people of God say praise the Lord. And right where you are to shout hallelujah. For our God indeed is a good God, and he is worthy to be praised. And therefore we give honor to our Lord and our Savior, who is indeed the head of our life, Jesus the Christ. Amen. To the Reverend Linda Sumter, to the Reverend Eloise Gladden, amen, to our beloved First Lady, Sister Lashelle Beth Simpson, the prettiest First Lady in all African Methodism, we give the Lord praise. And to our wonderful young people who are here with us this morning as we celebrate the end of the month of February, Black History Month. Children, give the Lord some praise. Let the whole world know that you are here this morning to help praise the Lord. Amen. At this time, let us look to the Lord in prayer as we invoke the Spirit of God. Lord, thank you so much for being so good to us. You've blessed us in so many wondrous ways. And Lord, we are here to worship you. We invoke your presence. Lord, you're welcome into our atmosphere. Lord, have your way in our presence. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place, and this worship service is in your hands. Get into the clapping of our hands, O God, and get into the singing of our voice, O Lord, and get into the reading of the scripture as well as the praying of the prayer. Get into the giving of the tithes and the offering, and Lord, get into the Black History program that we're getting ready to do this morning. Get into the preacher man right now and the preaching of the word, that you may set the atmosphere, that someone that needs you, O Lord, may come to you and give their life unto you and receive eternal life. For it's in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray, and the blessed people of God said, amen. Let's give the Lord praise all over the house this morning. Amen. Our scripture reading to set the tone for the last Sunday of February, Black History Month, which is also the last Sunday of Epiphany. Epiphany is a season that lasts several Sundays, and this is the last Sunday of Epiphany, as well as Black History Month. We are transitioning into Lent season. Ash Wednesday is this coming Wednesday, and we need to prepare our hearts and minds as to what it is that we want to sacrifice for our Lord during Lent season, that we may gain more of him. But we will be reading from the Old Testament book, the book of Exodus, chapter 34, reading verses 29 through 35, and it reads this way. And it came to pass, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimonies in Moses' hands, when he came down from the mountain, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with them. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. And Moses called unto them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him, and Moses talked with them. And after a while, all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them a commandment in all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And till Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. But when Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he took the veil off until he came out. And he came out and spoke with the children of Israel, which he was commanded. Verse 35. And the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone. And Moses put the veil upon his face until he went in to speak with him. Thus ends the reading of the word of God. Thanks be to God, and bless the people of God. Let's give the Lord some praise this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. At this time, we're going to have the reading of our announcements. Amen. And I believe that I'm going to read from our church calendar first. We are getting ready to move into the month of March. Amen. And so there are some things that are coming in the month of March that we need to recognize on our church calendar. Amen. Praise the Lord. As spoken, Ash Wednesday is coming this Wednesday, March the 2nd. Initially, the plan was to have a Ash Wednesday worship service. But right now, we are not in person right now, but we will be in person on the first Sunday of March. Let's give the Lord some praise. Amen. We are coming off of being strictly virtual, and we are coming back in person. With a modified registration list, initially we were registering 70 people for worship service. That number has been cut down back to 50. And so because of what is going on around us with the coronavirus, we're going to come back in cautiously. Amen. And we are going to gradually bump that number back up once we see that things are safe and we're able to do that. But we will be back in person on the first Sunday of March. But this coming Wednesday, we will not have the in-person worship service for Ash Wednesday as I intended, since we had to take a back step because of the coronavirus. But what I will do during the day, early that morning around 8 o'clock, I'm going to do an Ash Wednesday devotion. I'm going to do an Ash Wednesday devotion on Facebook Live. Amen. And so normally on Ash Wednesday, we have the ashes from last year's Palm Sunday, and we mix it with olive oil, anointed oil, and you normally will come and receive the imposition of the ashes upon your foreheads as a symbol of a sign of mourning and fasting and praying. So we're getting ready to go into the season of fasting and praying. So that morning at 8 a.m. on Facebook Live, I am going to do some devotional readings that morning by Ash Wednesday, so that we can start the season of fasting and praying. Amen. On March the 11th through the 13th, the 7th Episcopal District will be having their YPD annual retreat. Amen. And so registration is still open right now. Our YPD president is among us right now, and so if you would like for your youth to come and to attend the YPD retreat, let us be mindful that we still need to register so that our youth can participate in the ministry that is tailored for them. Young people, this is your ministry. And so it's for you to participate and to do the thing that you would like to do. But at the same time, there are certain requirements that the Southern Episcopal District is requiring us to do. Such things as vaccinations and COVID-19 testing, things of that nature. So it's no different than what we've been doing at our annual conferences. So they're requiring us, for your safety, to make sure those things are in place if you're registered and decide that you want to come and attend the YPD annual retreat. Amen. Also on March the 18th through the 20th, there's going to be the Seventh Episcopal District M. Suavos and PK's retreat place to be announced. Okay, so those are the announcements that are on the church calendar. Amen. And I'm flipping back to announcements that are on my cell phone. Technology is amazing that you can put everything on one apparatus and work from there. None of all this killing tree business anymore. Amen. But we're going to continue on with the reading of our announcements. Registration is open now for the mid-year convocation. The mid-year convocation is scheduled for April the 21st through the 23rd. It's going to be hybrid, and what that means is it's going to be a combination of being in person as well as virtual. Clergy, of course, we have no choice but to be there in person. And those, the laity, if you'd like to register so that you can watch it virtually, you may do so. So at this time, the registration is open for the mid-year convocation, which will be held at the Florence Civic Center on April the 21st through the 23rd. The second quarterly conference is scheduled for March the 30th, and that will be virtually. That will be the last Wednesday of March. It's going to be at 7 p.m. I've already received the link from our presiding elder for our second quarterly conference. I'm asking all auxiliaries, please begin to start taking down information to prepare your reports. When the presiding elder comes to hold his quarterly conference, he's looking for the YPD to respond. He's looking for the WMS to respond, the lay organization. You need to tell him what it is that you're planning to do. What did you plan to do in this second quarter? What did you do during the second quarter? So please, ma'am, please, sir, if you are an auxiliary president or you are a person that is on the steward board or the trustee board, whatever ministry that you're affiliated with, please begin to start thinking about the things, the goals that you have intended to do, to share with the presiding elder. As mentioned last Sunday, the DMC virtual ceremony has been rescheduled. I'm still waiting for that date. And I want to thank Sister Deidre Fuller for working with our young people doing the DMC ministry. Let's give the Lord some praise. Amen. Amen. We have a wonderful young people's ministry here at Mount Olive Amy Church. Amen. We have a wonderful DMC commissioner, Deidre Fuller. We have a wonderful YPD president. Amen. Sister Tracy Pelzer. And all the host of persons that work with them to make our young people shine like the diamond rings that they really are in Mount Olive Amy Church. But that the DMC ceremony has been rescheduled, and I'm still waiting to hear from Supervisor Phyllis Green as to when that will be. Amen. I want to meet with the choirs. Amen. I know I've been saying this for quite a spell, and now I finally decided now it's time for us to meet. I want to meet before we get back into the church. I want to meet with all the choir members of our church, and I want to meet with all our musicians at one time so I can just sit and lay out the expectations of the pastor as well as hear from the choir members. And we're going to do that big conference call, amen, because we have a lot of persons who are singing on our choirs, amen. So we're going to do that big conference call, and that conference call number, and I will send that conference call number out to all the choir presidents. And I'm expecting the choir presidents to send that down to all the choir members to be on the conference call tomorrow night at 7:30 p.m. I'll say that again, tomorrow night at 7:30 p.m. And I said it at that time because I want to make sure that if you're working, you're able to get off from work, give yourself some time so that everyone can be together to hear the expectations of the pastor as well as the pastor hear the expectation of those choir members as well as church musicians. And that conference call number is 978-990-5054, access code 321-1559. As I stated, I will be sending it out to the choir presidents, and they should be forwarding that to you sometime today after worship service. Amen. Let us be mindful that we are still receiving our tithes and offerings at 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Please, ma'am, please, sir, bring your tithes and offerings. If you're going to give it virtually, you may continue to do so virtually, but we will be here. The Finance Committee will be here to receive your tithes and your offerings. Amen. At 11 a.m. Praise the Lord. Let's be mindful to keep all of our sick and shut-in members lifted in prayer all over the church. Let us pray for Sister Martha Stoops. She is in the hospital this past week, and she had surgery, and she's recovering quite nicely. So we want to continue to pray for her. We want to pray for all of our sick and shut-in members all over the church. Amen. We want to continue to pray for those who are going through bereavement. Amen. We had a wonderful homegoing celebration down here at Mount Olive Amy Church graveside for Sister Mother Hattie Lee Pelzer Green. Amen. Wonderful homegoing celebration. The Lord blessed her to live 95 years. The Lord, He only promised us 70. That means the Lord promises us 70 years of good, Christian, sound, godly living. And if the Lord blesses you to live longer, He has rewarded you for your faithfulness here on earth. But she lived to see 95. We had a wonderful celebration on yesterday, but we want to continue to pray for that wonderful family. Also continue to pray for those who are still going through their bereavement. Yesterday was the third weekend in a row that I had been at a funeral. Third weekend in a row. Amen. So let us continue to pray for those who are going through their hour of bereavement. Amen. And let's pray for those, let's pray for everyone in the land. There's so much sickness, so much dying and death in the land. We need your prayers. Amen. So let us pray to the Lord that the Lord will continue to strengthen all of our sick and shut-in members, as well as those who are still heartbroken from losing their loved one. Let's give the Lord some praise in the church this morning. Amen. So now we've gotten all of our wonderful announcements out of the way, and we get back into worship. And here is where we worship the Lord through giving. The Bible says that it's much more blessed to give than it is to receive. It also says that if you give, he will what? He will give it back to you. He'll give it to you pressed down, shaken together, running over. Your hands will be able to hold it all. And he says, men will literally give back unto your bosom. God's word does not lie. It tells the truth. And I have trusted the Lord all this time. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Amen. So if you're giving by way of your tithe and envelopes, hold your tithe and envelopes up high in the air. Amen. If you trust God, believe God, and know God will do what he said that he would do. And if you're giving by way of Givelify, amen. The link is right there on our page right now as you're watching this worship service. Hold up your electronic devices. Amen. If you're giving by way of Givelify, let us pray. Oh God, I thank you so much for being so good to me. Lord, I thank you so much for being so good to my members, my mother. Lord, I thank you so much for being so good to those who are listening, oh God, who are not members of our church. You've been good to the world, oh God. You didn't have to do it anyway, oh God, but you gave us what we have. And what we have, Lord, we want to worship you with it, oh God. We want to give it back to you as an act of worship and love and adoration for you. And Lord, we pray as we worship you with our tithes and offerings. We pray, God, that you will bless our offering. Multiply it, O God, that it will be used for the upkeep and the building of thy kingdom. For it's in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray, and the blessed children of God said, amen. Amen. Your offerings have been blessed in advance, and so when you come to drop it in the tithing box, you drop it in the box knowing that the Lord has already heard the prayer for the blessing. Amen. So now at this time, I could not wait to see my children this morning. Amen. I am smiling from ear to ear. Amen. With this big Kool-Aid smile because I love seeing my members. Amen. And so our youth have put a wonderful Black History program together. Amen. Under the leadership of Sister Tracy Perlzer and Sister Deidre Fuller and all those working with them. And our young people are going to come up first and they're going to do some Black History speeches. Amen. And let me find the wonderful names. I'm going to read the names of my children and tell you who they're going to read about. Amen. Sister Skylar Miller is going to come and read about Althea Gibson. Amen. And Brother Xavier Clinton is going to be reading about Colin Powell. And he's dressed in his wonderful uniform. Amen. Looking like a soldier in the army of the Lord. Sister Michaela Rush, amen. One of my favorites, Maya Angelou, with her saying, when people show you who they are, you what? Believe them, and believe them the first time. Brother Jalen Fuller, our former president, amen. Barack Obama, let's give the Lord praise, amen. Sister Carrie Summerson, Mary McLeod Bethune, amen. The inventor of hair products, amen. All of our wonderful, lovely, lovely Black women. That's why their hair looks so lovely, because of Sister Bethune, amen. And Sister Kirsten Rush is going to come reading about Ruby Briggs. And Sister Jordan Miller is going to be coming by one of our favorites, Sister Harriet Tubman, amen. And after they come and read their speeches, I'm going to come back with further observations. Let's give the Lord some praise as they come. Amen.
Althea Neal Gibson was born on August 25th, 1927 in Chaldon County, South Carolina. Did you know that she was a famous tennis and golf player? Also, she won a Grand Slam title in 1956 and a Female Athlete Award in 1946. Also, she retired 1958 and died September 28th, 2003.
Amen. Let's give her praise. Amen. Colin Luther Powell was born April 5th, 1937 in Harlem, New York. I was the son of Jamaican immigrants Luther and Maude Powell. I was raised in South Bronx and educated in New York City public schools, graduating from Morris High School in 1954 without any definite plans for where I wanted to go in life. I joined the Army and retired as a four-star general and a statesman. I was chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff from 1989 through 1993. I was the 65th United States Secretary of State from 2001 to 2005, serving under President George W. Bush. I was the first African-American appointed to that position. I met Alma Vivian Johnson of Birmingham, Alabama, and married in 1962. Together we have three children, Michael, Linda, and Anna Reed Powell. I am Colin Luther Powell.
Maya Angelou is a famous American poet and activist who explored themes of economic and racial oppression. She's famous for her unique and pioneering autobiographical writing style. She made many different poems in her life. One of them is called Still I Rise. Here's a part of Still I Rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset, gloom? Because I walk like I got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides. Just like hopes spring high, still I'll rise.
August 4th, 1961. He served as the 44th president of the United States from 2009 to 2017. He was the first African American president of the United States. One of his famous quotes were, "We did not come to fear the future. We came here to shape it."
Mary McLeod Bethune was born in Maysville, South Carolina, to parents who had been slaves. She took an early interest in becoming educated with the help of benefactors. After college, she was an American educator, womanist, and civil rights activist. She died on May 18, 1955 at the age of 79 in Daytona Beach, Florida. Yeah,
7, she was the first black child to go to an all-white school. But when she got there, people did not want her there, all because of the color of her skin. In 1999, the Ruby Bridges Foundation was created.
Harriet Tubman was born in 1822 and died in 1913. She was an American abolitionist and political activist. She was born into slavery, but when she escaped, she made 13 missions to rescue 70 enslaved people, all by using a network of anti-slavery activists and safe houses such as the Underground Railroad. Wait a minute, there are slaves right there.
While the clouds roll back and the stars
let's give our children some more praise. Amen. Amen. I am so proud of our young people. Let's give the Lord, let's give them some more praise. Amen. Amen. Yes, we have some very talented young people who are with us this morning here at Mount Olive Baby Church. And that is just a handful. We have a ton of talent among our young people at Mount Olive. Let's give the Lord some more praise this morning. Amen. Amen. And so that is what you're going to be looking forward to when we get back in church. Amen. On the first Sunday of March, praise the Lord. So I just can't wait to see what the Lord has in store for us as we come back for in-person worship. Amen. So now it is time for us to prepare to receive a word from the Lord. Amen. And our guest preacher is here. Amen. And he has just graced us with his wonderful presence. Amen. And our wonderful young people, one of our wonderful young people, I was asking, do you feel like singing this morning? And before I could even finish my sentence, they were like, yeah, I'm ready to sing. I want to sing. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I'm going to ask our wonderful young people, and I'm going to ask Brother Jalen if you would come and get in place. Amen. So our young people can sing the preacher up. Amen. You know, one thing I believe in, you know, our young people, they deserve a seat at the table. Praise the Lord. And I'm going to allow you to wear your seat out every chance you get at the table that God has given you. So I'm going to allow our young people to sing our preacher up this morning, whatever the Lord has laid on their hearts. I know that they have not practiced, but I know that's okay. They always are ready and prepared to give God praise. Amen. Amen. So at this time, I'm going to introduce my son. Amen. I always refer to him as my child. Amen. I remember him when he was the size of little Kirsten. Amen. He was knee-high to a duck standing on a podium trying to look over and preach. And at the size of little Kirsten, wow, he had so much power and maturity as a child preaching God's word. And now he is all grown up. He's 25 years old. Amen. The same age as my youngest son, amen. We call him little Malcolm. He's the same age as my baby boy, amen. He's already graduated from college, amen, to get his first degree. Graduated from Morris College in Sumter, South Carolina. I believe that you graduated from the religion program there, am I correct? Amen. He's going on to academically study God's word. Let's give the Lord some praise, amen. Amen. And I believe that you're working at Denmark Tech as a counselor? South Carolina State. Praise the Lord. I know he's in one of those schools. Amen. Let's give the Lord some praise. Amen. So he's there at South Carolina State. He's graduated from college. But one thing I love about this young man, he is consistently the same in love with the Lord. Amen. And the brother can preach. Amen. And he will preach. Amen. And he has been there so many times, and our young people in this pastor have fallen in love with him, and we just keep calling him back and calling him back so that he can preach a wonderful, powerful message here at Mount Olive AME Church. So without further ado, I introduce to you and present the song after the singing of our wonderful youth, the Reverend Desmond Anthony. Let us give the Lord praise for our wonderful preacher of the hour. At this time, our youth will give us a wonderful selection. Amen. Thank you.
If you believe it, if you're happy for the young man, I want you to begin to clap your hands
and give God praise in here. I know there's a few of us in here and we got our masks on, but you can give God praise, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty and there is freedom. I dare you to get out of yourself. I dare you to get out of what you feel and begin to give God praise in here. I feel the presence of God already. I would not attempt to go that way, but I feel the presence of God already, and I thank God for your pastor. Let's give God praise for Pastor Simpson. I love him so much, and he's one of the only people I will ever tell, whenever he calls, I'm coming. He's one of the few, even down to the point where I will cancel somebody and come for your pastor. Because I love him so much, and he's such a genuine, and he has a magnificent heart for God and God's people. And to First Lady Simpson, I love you as well, and all the children. And all of you that are here, I am so glad that you're here. I want to get right to the word of the Lord, right into the book of Colossians, chapter number 3, and verse 13. I really wrestled. First of all, give me honor. Bring greetings from Kingdom Life Ministries in Orangeburg, South Carolina. My pastor is Overseer James Ross, and he allowed me to come in. I want to throw that out there. Amen. Pastor Simpson, I really wrestled with this word that the Lord gave me, because I was like, Lord, why would you give me this kind of word? And it's a Black History program. And then when I woke up this morning and I was getting ready, the Lord reminded me of something, and it's a unpopular message, but it is a needed message. I'll say it like that. It's unpopular, but it's needed. Colossians 3 verse 13 says, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you have a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. I simply want to talk about the power of forgiveness. The power of forgiveness. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Father, I pray that you use me for your glory. Father, heal, deliver, and set free. Father, I pray that somebody's life is totally transformed by this word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, and those that are watching via Facebook, and those that are here in the sanctuary with us, I need you to talk back to me. Me and Pastor Simpson may be the only ones preaching today, because this seems to be a very hard truth for the people of God to accept. The walk of a Christian seems easy in many aspects, and to some people it may seem glamorous and wonderful, however we may make it seem to be. But one of the most difficult challenges in our walk with Christ is the responsibility of forgiving. Forgiveness, hear me, is not optional, but is a prerequisite for a believer. In other words, you don't have the option of whether or not you want to forgive an individual. The longer you may not do it, God will enforce a situation to where you're uncomfortable, to where you have to forgive an individual. Sometimes God will, I have seen it, God has put certain people on their deathbed, and God has allowed certain people to get on their deathbed, and before they close their eyes to die, they have to ask for forgiveness. Or not even just ask for forgiveness, but forgive a certain individual. The Bible says it here. Whenever the Bible, Pastor Simpson, talks about forgiveness, it never asks you to do it. It doesn't give different options to avoid forgiveness. But the Bible simply commands us to forgive. Can I parenthetically insert this? That's what sets us apart as Christians, is that we have the ability and the responsibility to forgive. My brothers and sisters, what I found out is that unforgiveness creates an emotional storm of distress, in which feelings of stress, anxiety, depression, insecurity, and fear surface. All of these things surface when you have unforgiveness in your heart. Matter of fact, many of us, we say, I ask the Lord to forgive him, and God gonna do it. You know, we have our little saying, the Lord gonna handle that, the Lord gonna do it. But my brothers and sisters, in Matthew chapter number 6 and verse 14, the Bible even said, Jesus said, you must forgive your brother before you ask for forgiveness from the Father. Let me tell you something. You must have the ability and you must have the urgency to forgive. Because the longer you harbor unforgiveness in your heart, you will develop these things of stress. You will develop these things of anxiety. And sometimes what you will understand is that when you don't do it and you forget about it, does not mean that God is swept it under the rug. Sometimes those things catch up with you later on in life. And let me tell you something. This may be for somebody on Facebook Live and may not be for anybody in the sanctuary. But I don't care what somebody did to you. I want to say this, and I may be jumping ahead, but forgiveness is bigger than the offense. I said forgiveness is bigger than the offense. So what I'm saying is, the feelings that you have, you know when you have not forgiven an individual.
Yes. Mm-hmm. All right.
Because it clouds you. It harbors in your heart. It harbors and you begin to be depressed. And some will say, I'm not depressed. But there is a thing called functional depression. To where you are functioning as a regular individual, but you are not normal. It allows you to live, but it doesn't allow you to be free. I said, it allows you to live, but it doesn't allow you to be free. Unforgiveness, my brothers and sisters, is a weight. It's a weight. And whenever you hold this weight in, it contradicts everything in your life. Can I say this? That unforgiveness, your love for God, let me say it like this, the will of God for your life, your purpose for life, is blinded when you harbor unforgiveness. What I'm saying is, many of us, we ask the question, well, Lord, what is it that you really want me to do? I don't know my purpose. I don't know what you have planned for my life. And let me tell you something, it is not for you to try and figure those things out, because sometimes God has already given you the answer, but you just harbor too much in your life to where it blinds you from seeing what God really has for you. Let me tell you something, when you harbor unforgiveness, the person or persons that offended you are sleeping good at night, but it keeps you up in the midnight hour. It keeps you up in paranoid. It keeps you in depression. It keeps you in anxiety. It keeps you in stress. And all God is saying to you is that forgiveness is not letting you win, but forgiveness is letting you be free. Can I tell you something? I feel like preaching already. I got to calm down. I got to go to my church. Forgiveness, your freedom, your liberality, your stress freedom, your joy is attached to your forgiveness. So matter of fact, you may be feeling like you're locked up and bound. It's maybe because you need to tell somebody, I forgive you. And does not mean that you have the right to do it. Hold on 1 second, because many of us, we think that it's just saying, I you, but it is a process to forgiveness. Forgiveness is not something that you sporadically do. Matter of fact, to all of us in here, I come not to give you a pity party as to why you harbor unforgiveness. No, this is not the season anymore for that. Because matter of fact, there is too much going on. There is too much calamity. There is too much death for you to be holding on to something. When somebody, and many of us, we hold on to unforgiveness, and we allow ourselves to get offended by things that really don't even matter. We allow offense to set in to things that really wasn't important. Somebody bumped into you, and all of a sudden now you mad, and you can't even talk to the person. You can't even talk to them when they come to church. And all they was trying to do was move out the way, and they bumped you, and you got upset because somebody did not say, I'm sorry, or excuse me. Forget it. There are people that's dying from cancer. There are people that are dying from car accidents. There are people that are going through life circumstances, and you holding on to something that's really not that important.
Nelson Mandela said it, and I quote, he said, hating someone is drinking poison and expecting them to die. In other words, you are the one that's harboring unforgiveness is poison. And the more you drink it, it is killing you. And you expecting the other person that offended you to die from it. When all it's doing is getting at your heart. It is getting at your emotions. It is getting at your mental health. Maybe, just maybe, the reason why that relationship in your life can't work is because you haven't forgiven somebody previous before them. Maybe, just maybe, the reason why you can't even properly raise your children, is because you have not properly forgiven your parents. The reason, just maybe, you can't be free at this new job that you have is because you have not forgiven the boss that fired you. Maybe, just maybe, the reason why you can't receive a word from the Lord from Pastor Simpson is because you haven't forgiven the previous pastor, or you haven't forgiven the previous church. Y'all ain't gonna help me preach, but I'm preaching anyway. Unforgiveness is poison. It will kill you and leave you in a lonely grave all by yourself. Unforgiveness, it will kill you and have you on a highway to hell because you don't know how to forgive somebody else. Well, Pastor, I hear you. You don't know what they did to me. You don't know what they said. You don't know how it happened. But don't you know? The Bible says while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And he gave his life for us. And he forgave all of us. Matter of fact, he forgave us before there ever was a us. He forgave us before there ever was a problem. He forgave us before there ever was a situation. So why is it so hard to forgive someone? Y'all don't like me today, but it's all right. Because unforgiveness is a weight. Pastor Simpson, so many of us, we are walking around as if everything is all right. We're walking around as if everything we're doing is fine. And what I found out about unforgiveness is when you harbor it, you're trying to get materialistic things to compensate for your unforgiveness. You try to buy a car to make you feel better. Get a house, make you feel better. You buy some Louis Vuittons and some Gucci and Louis and all those things to compensate And then many of us, we have the nerve to keep moving in relationships. And we get in one relationship and it don't work. We get in the next one and it don't work. We get in another one and it don't work. And we over here are settling for temporary gratification. And we are allowing these things to compensate. And after a while, when you don't deal with the unforgiveness, God will place a situation in your life to where the rubber really meets the road. And you can't avoid this wall that he puts up. And you can't avoid what happens after that. And you have to face it. Can I tell you something? You cannot conquer what you don't confront. You can't conquer it if you don't confront it. You can't win over it if you don't confront it. I know they molested you. I know they raped you. I know they lied to you. I know they mishandled you. I know they lied to you. I know they did all of these things. I know they treated you worse than the other children. They made you feel like a black sheep. They made you feel all of these things. But let me tell you something. There comes a point where the hurt has to be dwindled. And you got to face it for yourself. And God will give you the courage to say, I forgive you.
Hallelujah.
My brothers and sisters, I'm afraid because we got people that are leading with unforgiveness. We got people that are doing all kinds of things, and you can tell those that harbor unforgiveness in their heart for years. It's because you ought to get tired. Let me just say, you ought to get tired of going to the family reunion and avoiding the offender. That's for somebody on Facebook. I'm sorry. You ought to get tired of going to work and going around the person that hurt you. You ought to get tired of coming to church and instead of trying to avoid an individual. And many of us, we have the nerve to think that if we don't see somebody for years and we feel good about it, that we have moved on. But that's not even the truth. Can I tell you something? That avoidance does not mean deliverance. Avoidance does not mean deliverance. Just because you don't see an individual for a long time doesn't mean what you felt 20 years ago has gone away. Because all it takes is for you to get into the presence of that individual. And all it takes is for you for somebody to mention that person's name. And all of a sudden, you ever been with one of your friends and they had one of those relationships that they just got out of and they said, you know what, I'm over it. I'm big past him. I've been past her. But soon as you start talking about him, all of a sudden they start to rant. Now why are you talking about him? Now why are you talking about him? And they start ranting and doing all these things. It's because you're not over it. The plan of God, the move of God, can be aborted because we don't forgive. That was a little heavy, and some of y'all may not understand it right now. But what God has called you to, maybe the marriage that you desire, and I believe I'm finished, the marriage that you desire, the freedom and the peace and the joy that you desire is held to the unforgiveness. The reason why I wrestled with this word so is because I was like, God, why would you give me a word about the power of forgiveness? Is he told me this morning while I was brushing my teeth on the way here. He said, Desmond, the African American culture struggles with letting go. Think about it. We're the only ones that still want what's due to us. We're the only race that's popular for having division amongst each other.
Amen.
Give me a prime example, preacher. Black and black crime. While we yet being killed by white officers, we in our own neighborhoods killing ourselves.
Amen.
Over nothing. Mm. Over stuff that can be resolved in a conversation.
Amen.
Many people miss out on their lives because of miscommunication. Many people miss out on the destiny that God has planned for them because of miscommunication.
Amen.
Sometimes the unforgiveness that we have in our heart really wasn't so much that they did anything wrong. It was miscommunication.
Amen.
But we allowed the devil to get into it.
Amen.
And that's all the enemy needs is a little space to get in between and make something that was so small so big. Now all of a sudden, now you want to out somebody on Facebook. Now all of a sudden, you don't want to talk to somebody. Unforgiveness breaks God's heart. Y'all hear me? I said unforgiveness breaks God's heart. He's a father. And any parent does not want to see their children at odds with each other. If you're a parent in here, the worst things for you to see is when your children don't get along. One of the worst things that can break a parent's heart, they can do all the things they want to do outside in the world, but the ones that you raise and put your hands on, when they don't get along and they don't like each other, it breaks a parent's heart. Because you came from me. God gave you me. God gave you these children. And you're fighting each other. That's what happens when we come to church and we don't talk to each other.
Amen.
That's what happens at the family reunion when we gossiping about each other. That's what happens when we start killing each other. It breaks God's heart. Let me tell you something. Don't miss what God wants for you. And one of the main points I will always say is that forgiveness is not for the other person. Mm-hmm. It's for you.
Amen. Yes.
And we have created, glory to Jesus, I feel your presence here. I said, so many of us, we have allowed the enemy to, and this is one of the things, and I gotta go, this is one of the things how you know it's the enemy. Is that he will create scenarios in your head.
Come on, preacher.
About an individual.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you get to the person, it's nothing what you thought it was going to be.
Amen. Right. Amen.
That's how powerful the enemy works in our minds.
Mm-hmm.
Could I tell you something and I hear the Lord?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Could it be that the person you need to forgive is waiting on you?
Oh, hallelujah.
Or could it be the person that you need to forgive is yourself?
Yes.
Come on, preacher.
Sometimes the forgiveness that we need to do is within us. I'm sorry for allowing myself to get out of character.
I ask for forgiveness for thinking such about an individual. I ask for forgiveness for treating somebody that was didn't deserve what I gave them.
This word is for somebody today. It wasn't for somebody, it was for me.
I wish I didn't even get through half of my notes. If Pastor Simpson let me come back, I'll finish it.
Is that
one of the things and I promise I'll finish, I gotta pray and leave, is that one of the processes to forgiving a person is acknowledging what you feel. Sometimes that's the hardest process, acknowledging how you feel, because you don't want to feel it. You run away from the feeling. You run away from the emotion. But when you face what you feel, you have won half of the battle. Because now you're strong enough to even ask and receive the forgiveness. Even if they don't accept it, you did what you're supposed to do.
Yes. Oh, yes.
There is freedom in forgiveness. Can somebody shout, there is freedom,
there is freedom.
In forgiveness? Don't say it again. There is freedom in forgiveness. One more time. There is freedom in forgiveness. Can you imagine what kind of church you would really have when everybody's heart is clear? Can you imagine what kind of church you would have? What kind of life? You know how many businesses some of y'all could have had if you would relinquish what was in your heart?
Come on, preacher.
Could you even imagine how much further in your life you could have been if you would have released it and let it go? There is freedom in forgiveness. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for this word. I thank you for saying what was needed. Father, I pray that this message helped someone. Father, I pray that the little bit that was shared would free somebody. Father, I pray for the heart of a person right now. I pray for the brokenhearted. Somebody has been walking around smiling, but really on the inside they were dying. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you will bring the spirit of forgiveness to their life. Father, I pray for somebody on Facebook Live. Father, I pray that you will strengthen them. Give them courage. Give them boldness. Give them power over the offense and the offender, even if the offender is ourselves. Father, I pray. One of the purest forms of worship is a heart to forgive. Father, give us the motive, give us the intent to forgive right away without holding anything. Letting it go and letting it be. Father, thank you for this church. Thank you for this pastor. Thank you for this first lady. Father, I pray that whatever you're doing in this season, don't do it without them. Bless them. Keep them. Cover them. Favor them. Grace them. In Jesus' name. If you believe it, put your hands together and give your hands. I'm done. But I want you to hear me good. We're living in the last days. I don't know about Pastor Simpson, but for me, one of the things that I'm not doing anymore is just preaching to make you happy.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let me tell you something. One of the assignments that God has given me
is to preach truth.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes.
If you did not want, if you did not want to acknowledge it or not, I know I have a relationship with the Father. I walk with Him. Even for some people in here this morning, this word was for you. I know it was. You don't have to tell me. I know it. And if you walk in forgiveness, you're going to walk into the greatest day of your life. You're going to walk into one of the greatest seasons of your life. That's why you have been repeating cycles in your life. It seems like you keep experiencing the same thing over and over and over again. And you go every day and nothing is happening. Nothing is changing. It's because you have been rehearsing the same feeling inside of you. One of the assignments that God has given me is to preach truth. I don't want to lie to you and tell you that your blessing is coming in 3 days, because if it's God's will for the blessing to come in 3 days, it's going to come in 3 days. I ain't got to tell you that. But I want to tell you that it's your responsibility and my responsibility to help you to live right. And preach the word of God. Because there's a war going on. And let me tell you something, saints of God, you don't have to believe me. What's today's date? February what? 27th? All right. Y'all can mark it right here that on February the 27th, that Reverend Desmond Anderson, that in this world, if we as believers don't join together, it's going to get worse. I'm talking about to the point of where almost being like Ukraine, we have to evacuate. And me bringing my head back and screaming to you ain't gonna stop that. Days are gonna get worse. The Bible promised that. He said, your days will be full of trouble. But what gives you peace over trouble? Glory to God, is that relationship with God.
Yes, yes.
And I just want to tell you something, that you may not see me or hear me anymore, but I want to tell you that there is freedom in forgiveness. And there is freedom attached to it. God bless you. I love you. And may the love of God sustain you and keep you. And if you believe it, give God a hand of praise.
Very quickly, the preacher has to leave right now. Amen. And those of you who are in the room who know what I'm referring to, let us be gracious and swift immediately, because the preacher has another assignment. Amen. We don't want the preacher to leave without the blessing of the Lord upon him. Amen. So let us be swift on our assignment to make sure that we do what we're supposed to do as good Christians. Let us give the Lord some praise. And there was a reason, Sister Tracy, that the Lord allowed you to say Reverend Desmond Antley's name. The message lines up so timely. What point of the season are we in right now? We're getting ready to go into Lent season. A season of fasting and praying, and also what? Forgiveness. A supernatural season where God will begin to do great works in our lives. If we take fasting and praying seriously. So I'm going to read this very quickly and we're going to give the benediction. Normally I don't like to come behind such powerful anointed preaching, but God has set the stage for us, my Olivetti Church, for the season that we're getting ready to go into, talking about forgiveness. Amen. Lent season begins with Ash Wednesday. and lasts for 40 days, not counting Sundays, and ends on Saturday before Easter. This is a time of spiritual preparation through prayer, meditation for the festival of Easter. And so as we close from this wonderful worship experience, one of the things that we need to give up is unforgiveness. Hallelujah. During Lent season. And so whatever that one thing is that is causing you to not receive the blessings of Almighty God, hallelujah, amen. Whatever that thing is, we need to put that on the very forefront of our minds. Some of us have a laundry list of things that we need to put on the altar during this Lent season. And I want you to choose your scripture, and I want you to dedicate a time during the day for you to pray, amen, and fast. And let me tell you something, fasting doesn't necessarily mean that you just go without food, amen. It could be giving up meals, it could be giving up your breakfast, or it could be giving up something that you like the most, like the pastor loves Dr. Peppers, that one thing that you cling to the most, the one that really makes you feel it, if you don't have it. That is the thing that you give up during that season. As you fast, as you pray, as you meditate on scripture, and as you sing hymns unto the Lord. Amen. So at this time, we're going to receive the benediction of Almighty God. For this coming Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. Again, I'm going to be reading. I'm going to be doing some readings for Ash Wednesday to prepare us for a wonderful start of 40 days of fasting and praying. And when we get on the other side of Lent season, we're going to walk out more empowered in the name of Jesus, that we'll be able to do greater things in the Lord. So let us now receive the benediction. Now may the grace of God and the love of the Lord Jesus the Christ and the sweetest communion of his divine Holy Spirit may rest upon you. May it abide with you henceforth and forevermore. And the blessed people of God said, amen.
Need a healing, just say, oh.